share a warm welcome one with another. Please take note of the announcements, and as always, let us remember those on our special thoughts and prayers list. Note that Mary Martin's memorial service will be this coming Saturday, but it will be at 2, not 1. I think your bulletin may say 1, but it will be at 2 p.m. here in the chapel, followed by a reception. And Matthew and I will be leading that service. I would like to personally thank everyone who shared emails, text messages, and sent sympathy cards following the passing of my father on April 21st. You all have been so good the past few years to send cards to my mom and dad, and they greatly appreciate it. The service went as well as could be expected, but we appreciate your support, your thoughts, and your prayers. Now let us respond to the goodness of this wonderful Sunday we have been given as we join together in the spirit of worship, celebration, and fellowship. Our first hymn is number 436.
Thank you.
Oh God, how we meet this time apart in this sacred space where we can retreat from the demands and troubles of the world for just a little while, but where we can also reflect and hopefully gain new courage and strength to face the challenges of life and the world and gain a new perspective on what we might do to make a positive difference. So, during this time together, may we be uplifted, encouraged, and enlightened. In your name we pray, amen. I invite you to join me in the responsive reading today on compassion. Compassion is a foundation for sharing our aliveness and building a more human world.
It is a way of relating to places and things, and it is the key to transforming ourselves and others.
Compassion is having 1,000 eyes that see the pain in all corners of the universe, and 1,000 arms to reach out to all corners of the universe to extend help.
Compassion is just what the word says. It is suffering within.
Compassion is the quivering of the pure heart when we have allowed ourselves to be touched by the pain of life.
Compassion is the knowledge that there can never really be any peace and joy for me until there is peace and joy in my heart and in me.
Okay, I can't hear it. I must be going dead. Okay. I have a favorite story for you I want to share with you today. It's about a little boy named John. It's good, by the way, it's good to see you again. I haven't seen you in a while, have I? Good to see you. Yeah, no, I haven't. Good to see you. Once upon a time, a young man named Johnny woke up one morning and he decided he was not happy. And even though Johnny lived in a nice house, had plenty of food to eat, nice clothes to wear, and plenty of toys to play with, he was not happy. And so Johnny decided he was going to leave home in search of happiness. So he filled his backpack with food to eat, a peanut butter sandwich. Peanut butter sandwich, an apple, and a granola bar, and then he had a bottle of water on the other side to drink, and he set off down the road. Johnny had not traveled far when he came upon a little girl who was sitting beside the road crying because her bicycle had broken. Johnny was pretty good with bicycles, so he stopped to help. The chain had come off. So in no time at all, Johnny had the chain back on, and the little girl hopped on her bike and pedaled off down the road smiling. Seeing her smile made Johnny smile too. A little farther down the road, Johnny came upon a beggar who was holding a cardboard sign that said, "Out of work, in need of food." Johnny felt sorry for the beggar, so he reached in his backpack and took out the peanut butter sandwich and the apple, and gave it to the man. Tears formed in the man's eyes, and then he smiled, and Johnny smiled back. A mile or so farther down the road, Johnny came upon a woman who was struggling to rake the leaves off her small front lawn. Johnny removed his backpack and offered to help. "I would be happy to rake your leaves for you if you like," Johnny said to the woman, who sort of reminded him of his grandmother, who had just celebrated her 80th birthday. "Oh, what a fine young man," the woman said. "That would be so nice." So in no time at all, Johnny had the leaves raked and bagged. When he finished, the woman invited him to sit on her front porch to have some cookies and a glass of milk. While he ate the cookies and drank the milk, the two talked about all kinds of things. Books, both of them read, favorite subjects in school, baseball, and their favorite holiday of the year. As they talked, both Johnny and the woman smiled a lot. And all of a sudden, Johnny realized that he was happy. In fact, it occurred to him that he had been happy all day, ever since he had helped a little girl repair her bike. Soon it would be getting dark, so Johnny decided he had better start back home. He had gone in search of happiness, and he had found it. Happiness, he had learned, is in being kind to and helping other people who need help, sharing with those who are in need, and talking and smiling and connecting with other people. As long as he could be with and be kind to other people, Johnny decided, he would not need to look anywhere else for happiness. Something for you to think about this week. Have fun in Sunday school. It's so good to see you today. And I guess we're singing number 537, right?
Thank you.
Alone, we may think that we can do very little to make a difference, but together we can do a lot. With that thought in mind, we're invited to share our financial gifts to help make a positive difference in our community and wider world. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And our second reading comes from Henry Drummond. There is only one thing greater than happiness in the world, and that is holiness. And it is not in our keeping. But what God has put in our power is the happiness of those about us, and that is largely to be secured by our being kind to them. The greatest thing, says someone, a man can do for his Heavenly Father is to be kind to some of his other children. I wonder why it is that we are not all kinder than we are. How much the world needs it. How easily it is done. How instantaneously it acts. How infallibly it is remembered. Will you again join me in a time of prayer and silent reflection? Eternal God, our hearts have been broken anew this past week as we have witnessed more gun violence motivated by racial and political hatred that took more precious innocent lives. We pray for those victims and their families whose lives were shattered in an instant. And we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine. Those who have lost so much, those living in deprivation and daily terror, and those who have fled their homeland seeking safety. The world is far from being the world we would like for it to be. But perhaps as we look deeply into our own hearts and at our own lives, we find that neither are we yet the more mature and more perfect persons that we would like to be. Striving towards spiritual maturity, towards human maturity, we realize is not a destination but a journey. So may we have the grace and the determination to grow more Christ-like in our character and habits, as the writer of the letter to the Colossians challenges us to do. Even as we pray for our world and for ourselves, we also pray for those on our special thoughts and prayers list. Such are our spoken prayers, and now we would offer the silent meditation on our hearts. Amen. The world is in a mess, but you don't need me to tell you that. Ukraine has been decimated by Vladimir Putin and his ruthless Russian forces. Climate change has resulted in monstrous hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, and wildfires, all of which threaten to make parts of the world uninhabitable. Political divisions and hatreds threaten to tear America apart, even to the point of violent threats against congressional colleagues across party lines. Advances that have been made in racial relations and in LGBT rights are being reversed. Mass shootings motivated by racial hatred have become an epidemic. School boards and other groups are ramping up efforts to ban books and silence and distort the truth. Road rage incidents, including shootings on the highways, resulting in the deaths of innocent victims, have been on the rise. All of this could cause us to want to throw up our hands in defeat and go running and screaming into the woods as far as we could go. Is there anything we can do, we ask, to make a difference in our lives and in the world at large? A lack of kindness is destroying our world. Vladimir Putin and his Russian military forces continue to lead an unprovoked and ungodly assault upon the people of Ukraine. I watch the world news daily of which the top story often is the devastation and destruction left by Russian forces. One city after another where apartment buildings, hospitals, orphanages, schools, train stations, playgrounds, and more are bombed and burned, killing thousands of innocent civilians, including the aged, pregnant mothers, infants, and children. We watch in horror as residents of city after city and village after village lose everything in an instant by a missile blast, or worse, are left dead in the streets by shot by Russian soldiers. Millions of Ukrainians have fled violence to other countries, leaving behind everything or nothing, and with really no place to go and no way to support themselves. All of this has been rightly termed Putin's war. It is all at the direction, mostly, of one man bent on gaining more power, more land, and wealth, even if it means destroying everything on that land in the process. You know that Putin is one of the richest, if not the richest man in the world, gathered at the expense of others. I have been astounded that time and again that one power-hungry, deranged, or evil man can cause so much suffering and misery in the world. Think of it, one man and one man alone mostly is responsible. What we have witnessed in Ukraine and his actions have affected the entire world order and economies. It is obvious that Putin, and it would appear at least some of those closest to him, has no soul, as put by President Biden. And it is obvious to me that he has no inkling of a moral compass. And Putin doesn't know the meaning of compassion or kindness. It is with Putin, as the Apostle Paul stated it in Romans, he is one of those who have no conscience. They do not keep their promises, and they show no kindness or pity for others. Does that not describe Putin to a T? If Putin did have a soul, if he did possess a moral compass, if he did know anything about kindness or compassion, he would not be inflicting the suffering and misery upon the Ukrainians and the whole world as he has been doing. And the really scary thing is, Putin has access to nuclear weapons in a way that a like-minded demagogue of the last century, Adolf Hitler, did not. Well, thanks for letting me vent today. I've been needing to vent that for weeks. Thank you. Where in Putin's actions, this is the point, where in Putin's actions and the Russian invasion do we see any evidence of love, any evidence of compassion, justice, understanding, and kindness? Nowhere. Nowhere. However, we do see love, compassion, justice, understanding, and kindness in abundance in Ukraine's neighboring countries and people around the world who are taking in total strangers who have fled their homeland. And in the many relief, human relief agencies, volunteers, donors, and others who are giving of themselves and their resources to try to meet human need. I read just this past week that there are at least 3 Ukrainian families living now at Oak Ridge. So, what do I think is a key to a better life and a better world? A key to helping correct many of the problems cited earlier, it is pure and simple devotion to kindness as a way of life. Kindness as an attribute is a prominent theme throughout the Hebrew and Christian scriptures from beginning to end. Kindness is said to have been shown by God throughout the Bible in such places as Genesis, Exodus, Jeremiah, Joel, Jonah, and Luke, to cite a few examples. Kindness is coveted by the faithful throughout Genesis, and it is a longing cry over and again throughout the book of Psalms. Kindness is a prominent theme in the story of Ruth, and throughout 1 and 2 Samuel, especially 2 Samuel 9, which recounts the story of King David showing kindness to the physically challenged son of his close friend Jonathan. According to Job and Proverbs, those who are kind are said to fear and honor God. Those who show kindness will be blessed. And kindness is a type of boomerang that will come back to you. Kindness is one of the proofs that one is living in the Spirit of God. But even more important to be noted, according to Hebrew prophets Micah and Zechariah, kindness is one of the chief requirements of God. In one of the most important verses in the entire Hebrew and Christian scriptures, we hear 8th century prophet Micah thunder. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness, walk humbly with your God. And through the prophet Zechariah, this warning is sounded to all who would oppress, take advantage of, or inflict suffering upon the innocent and helpless. Show kindness and mercy to one another. Do not oppress the widow, the fatherless, the sojourner, or the poor, and let none of you devise evil against another in your heart. Take note, Vladimir Putin. Jesus reiterates these injunctions in the Gospel of Matthew, where he says, "It is kindness that I want." If you really knew what this means, you would not condemn people who are not guilty. One of the preeminent verses in all Christian scripture and foundational verses for living the right kind of life is found in Colossians that we read earlier. You must clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Surely this crash course on biblical kindness is enough to show that kindness and its siblings, love, compassion, and justice, is at the heart of the Judeo-Christian faith and should be and is an attribute of anyone who claims to fear and honor God. As writer F. Scott Fitzgerald reminds us, to be kind is more important than to be right. He says, many times what people need is not a brilliant mind that speaks, but a special heart that listens. Yet in recent years, we have seen a lot of emphasis upon being right. Or rather, we have seen a lot of, I'm right and you're wrong, so it doesn't matter what I do to you. And with that attitude and approach, kindness has been sacrificed on the altars of bigotry, ignorance, prejudice, and violence. Consider what happened on January 6, 2021, when a violent mob, every member of which was convinced he or she was right, stormed the United States Capitol, wreaking havoc, destroying public property, inflicting bodily harm and even death upon public servants who were there to serve and protect, and even threatening with death the Vice President and Speaker of the House. Where was any evidence of kindness in the January 6, 2021 insurrection? There was none. But such is what can happen when one elevates his own personal opinion and conviction that he or she is right over the universal rule of kindness. Kindness always outweighs rightness. For several years, I have heard of Henry Drummond, and on occasion, I have probably quoted him, but only recently, I decided to find out who Henry Drummond was and what he wrote. And I found that Drummond wasn't a prolific writer, but the few short works that he left us does have a lot to teach us. Drummond was a 19th century, forward-thinking, Free Church of Scotland evangelist, biologist, writer, and lecturer. He is probably best remembered for his short essay titled The Greatest Thing in the World. And in this short work, Drummond says, and he seems to be quoting, since he bookends this with quotation marks, "The greatest thing a man can do for his heavenly Father is to be kind to some of his other children." But in his own words, Drummond says, "There is only one thing greater than happiness in the world, and that is holiness, and it is not in our keeping. But what God has put in our power is the happiness of those about us. And that is largely to be secured by our being kind to them." In other words, there isn't anything we can really do for God in whatever way each of us may think of God. But we can do something for God's children. And that most important thing we can do is demonstrating kindness. So, what is the key to enriching our own lives and also making a positive difference in the world? That key is making a concerted effort and commitment to live a life of kindness. It is as that simple but powerful television public service ad encourages. It pops on the TV every now and then. Choose kindness. These two simple words say it all. We have a choice. We have a choice to live a life of kindness. And by so doing, we can do our small part in making a positive difference in the troubled world that we live in. Choose kindness. May it be so. Thank you. kindness of God be with us all. Amen.